Okay, welcome. Can you all hear me? Is the mic working? That's good. So that means that if you don't ask any questions, don't say anything or something like that, I think we can get home quite early. So because then I think I will talk too fast. I would really appreciate and like it if you ask questions and interrupt me and comment on everything, like give feedback. I'm not talking about something very technical here. I'm not showing any code like Heinz that actually was programming for 2 hours in front of you. So I have more slides and stuff like that instead. I'll talk about continuous delivery. But first I would actually like to know how many of you, like how well do you know it? How many is working with continuous delivery? So quite a few of you. How many is working continuous integration, have a build server at least? Okay, so most of you are in that area. What servers are you using? Jenkins, TMC, Jenkins, how many? Most of you. What version control? Git? Subversion? Mercurial? Anyone unfortunate enough to use ClearCase or
something old like that?
So, interesting. Okay, just quickly about myself, and I work for a company called Parkman, where we actually work a lot with continuous delivery. Not so much in the Java world, that's partly because it's too easy to do in the Java world, so you can do it without consultants, you just do it. You don't even have to go to a presentation like this, you just do it. We do it a lot for people who work with C++ and .NET and stuff like that, where it's quite a bit harder. But we also do it in Java, and we do it for our own development, which is in the Java world. We work a lot with Jenkins. We arrange Jenkins conferences here in Scandinavia. We have done the last 2 years, and we have developed a lot of plugins for Jenkins extensions and stuff like that, which is a big part of the Java development work we do ourselves. We also work with IBM tools. ClearCase actually support that a lot, and integration to Jenkins, this kind of world. And myself, I have worked lots of years in this business. I started out as a programmer, like everybody, then architect, then technical project manager, then project manager, then technical project manager, then programming a little bit, so back and forth. And at the moment, I'm what we call a continuous delivery coach. Everybody else can call themselves a coach, so we can too. And we help people introducing and implementing continuous delivery. What I plan to talk about, and again, if you ask questions or comment or say something, then we might go in a different direction than this. But I'll give an introduction to continuous delivery, what it is, at least seen from our side. Maybe we can do that reasonable quick, because it seems that most of you know what it is already. Then I'll show up like a demo of what it is we typically implement when we implement continuous delivery, which is a pipeline of quality assurance. Then I will talk a little bit about what we call continuous delivery maturity model. When you start implementing this, you actually start seeing how good you are at a lot of the things you're doing, how good is your build setup, how good is your quality assurance, how good are you at having test environments, things like that. So I'll talk about that kind of things. Then I'll tell some stories from the trenches, like things that we have implemented and what we usually do when we're out. I'll talk a little bit about why you should do this, the business case, and a little bit about how. Does that make sense? Or is there something missing? So we will start with the introduction. From our point of view, there's basically three main ways of starting and thinking about continuous delivery. Like the first one is actually from the continuous integration, saying that if we integrate our code all the time, it's not really enough to integrate. We actually want to do something more. We want to do some quality checks and really like more than just integrating it. So it's a natural next step to the continuous integration. That's one way of looking at it. Another one is actually like putting the effort on the delivery. Like, I don't know if you read the ThoughtWorks and Martin Fowler on there, that talks about continuous delivery, but they really mean delivery. Like, they mean that you have to put your code in production all the time, daily, weekly. That's what they call continuous delivery. Then what, and this is actually what we consider like a big part of it, is if you want to do agile development, if you want to work with Scrum and stuff like that, you really have to ensure all the time that your code is working. And if you have to deliver code in 3 weeks sprints, you can't have 3 weeks or 2 weeks to actually do quality assurance or testing. You have to automate that kind of things. So from our point of view, it's also like a natural part of agile development that you actually have to start implementing continuous delivery. How many of you are doing agile and Scrum? That wasn't a lot. What are the rest of you doing? Waterfall? I have some slides about agile Scrum. I guess you all know it, or it doesn't make sense spending more time talking about it, or like the was that a yes and a no? But some of the principles, some of the important things when you work agile and Scrum is actually that you actually try to work in like sprints, 3 weeks, however long they are. You have to ensure that the work you do in that period is actually done, like one of the, and not just done, but done, like it really has to be finished and working properly. One of the things that you do in Scrum is that you actually define, like how you define that it's good enough, that it's done, your code. And you have to, after 3 weeks, show something that is being signed off. Those of you working with Scrum, how many actually see problems in getting the code done, like that it's really working in 3 weeks, Scrum? And how many don't consider that a problem? Good. That was you. Yes. Only you. That's okay. That's it is also what we see in a lot of projects, that it works really well in the sprint, and you have some code that is reasonably finished, but it's not quite finished, and then you go on to the next sprint, and it's reasonably finished, but it's not quite finished, and the next sprint, and then you have to deliver into production. And then you get a little bit back in the waterfall and say, okay, now we have to ensure that it really works, and then you get this like more classical at the end of the project, that you really have to ensure you have to test it, and you have to ensure that your performance is okay. All of these things that you made some shortcut during the sprint cycles. And this is actually where we think that continuous delivery can help a lot. Does everybody know where the word continuous delivery comes from? Have everybody read the Agile Manifesto?
You have to.
So, beside this, the four major, if we should take it up here. Beside the four principles, there is actually 12, what is it, they call them in here, the 12 principles of agile software. And the first one actually says that we want to satisfy the customer too early and continue to deliver valuable software. So this is where this is where it's coming from. This is where it all started. And there's another one that I think is very important. I don't know if it's principle number 8 or 9, but the only real way you can measure progress is in working software. So, and to me, this is actually what we fail in a lot of, like our project management and with a lot of the Scrum, is that some of the things we do in the early projects, it's not producing working software, it's producing something else. And we think that the something else we produce tells us something about how long time it takes making our software. But it doesn't. Like, the only real thing that tells you something about how long time it takes making software is making software that is working. And if you can really ensure that your software is working in every sprint, that's when you start getting a really good idea about when you can finish your project on time. And again, like, this was the old waterfall process. When you go to the agile and the continuous delivery, you start doing all of these things all of the time. And it is really important that it has to be done. Like, you really have to try to ensure in each of this sprint that your code is good enough, that you could ship it if you wanted to. If you want to ship it or not, that can be a business decision. but it should be shippable. So how do you do that, and how do you automate that? What we normally implement and what we consider is the base of it is a pipeline, because if you want to do more than just continuous integration, but you actually want to quality ensure your code in a lot of different ways, you cannot do that in one go. Then it takes a lot of time, and it takes a lot of time before you tell back to the developer if his code was okay, if his commit was okay, yes or no. So you make a pipeline. You start out by building the code and running your unit tests. And that has to be fast. That has to run like in a few minutes at the most. And you tell back to the developer, yes or no. Like, your code was actually good enough that you can integrate it with your colleagues. Like, it's compiling, it doesn't destroy anything for anyone, and all unit tests it was. Then you go to the next step and say, okay, what can I do now to ensure that my code is actually working? What more can I do automatically? There's a lot of static code analysis that you can do and check, and we'll get more into some of that. How many of you are using things like FindBugs and things like that? And this again is one of the good things with the Java is that you have a lot of tools like that that helps you actually do static analysis on your code. There's tools for doing like the complexity of the code and all kinds of stuff that you can run, and it gives very useful information. If that goes fine, then you're ready for the next step. If it's not okay, if you don't meet your goal targets in those areas, you basically reject this commit and said, that commit didn't go down further in the process. If that's okay, then you say, okay, now I have to start doing some serious testing of this code, because now I've done what I can do, like statically. I deploy it somewhere, and I start running functional tests. At this time in the process, you can actually, it can run for hours, or days, if that's necessary, because it's not that you have to give a quick feedback to the developer. It's actually okay if this takes a long time if you really want to take your application seriously. So this can be a lot more work, and you can run it by testing like services and stuff, but you can also test your user interface, at least to a certain extent, automatically in this phase. And again, if that goes good, you can have some reviews, you can generate your documentation, your Java doc and all that stuff automatically. And at the end, if you're brave, you can have an automatic acceptance test. And if that goes good, then you put it into production. Does anyone have a pipeline like that? Yes? Yes. That's what I was trying a little bit in the beginning. Continuous delivery to us, we actually have a big focus on creating release candidates. I know ThoughtWorks and a lot of companies talk about it, that you deliver it into production, but we actually have a lot of customers that don't want to deliver things into production continuously. Partly because they can't, there's a lot of reasons. We work for industrial companies, they don't like deliver software continuously. But they would like to ensure that their code is working all the time. So to me, and I know everybody don't agree about that, but to me, continuous delivery is a question of creating release candidates all the time. And also to have an automated step for delivering it into production, if that's possible. But the last process of it, I consider manual. And I consider my job done when I can go to business and say, well, deliver, you decide. Like, this is a business decision. Like, our code is ready. Like, whenever you want to push the button, we will do it. So that's what I consider continuous delivery. We don't have a lot of focus in the work we do on the automated deployment and that kind of things. But that's mainly because that's not what our customers are focusing on. They want to ensure they have release candidates that have working software. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So I'm not saying you shouldn't automate all of that stuff, and you should have it as part of your pipeline. Because automating deployment and all of that also into production is a very important part of it. I just think for most people there's a manual step in deciding when you push things into production. But automating it is part of the process, from our point of view, if it's possible. And as you say, and this is something, and then we are, but how you then control this in the in your production environment, and can you actually deliver several versions of your code? So, and some users start using some versions, like you can when you're a Facebook user, and all of this kind of thing. Of course, there's a lot, depending on what environment you're in, there can be a lot of considerations about that. To some people, deploying into production is just moving a WAR file up. To other people, it's more complicated. Yes. Unless you're brave, yes, they would normally be manual steps, but we actually put them into our pipeline, and I can show that afterwards. We implemented it in Jenkins, so you actually go in there and press the button. For the review, if you're doing code review, we would also recommend that you put in like a review tool, and you have that as part of the process, so your code doesn't actually get further on in this pipeline unless somebody has accepted in these tools. So it's manual steps as part of the automated process.
Okay, so
I
have to go back to Jenkins and say it has been accepted?
You have to, yeah, if you do, we do that in Jenkins someplace where you have to go in Jenkins and push a button and say it's okay, but if you use a tool like Garrett or there's other tools for doing reviews, then the tool will handle it for you. And tell Jenkins that now it's okay, now you go to the next step. This is basically the same thing, but the way it looks in Jenkins. How many of you have seen a Jenkins pipeline?
One. That was not a lot. So we will go in and look a little bit more on how that works.
So this is basically the whole story. You start as a developer, you check in, basically for hopefully based on your work item, in your case, handling system. You check into your version control, yes, I'm done, it's working. Jenkins or somebody else starts this process, and if at some time it fails, it goes back to the developer and says, sorry, mate, not good enough. Or if it actually succeeds to all the steps, it will claim that the code is done, at least done to the furthest extent that we can check it with this process. Good. Let's look a little bit more at the pipeline. This is the way that Jenkins set it up and present a pipeline. This is basically like I think you can do more or less the same in other tools. I haven't seen another tool that have like the same nice graphical view of your pipeline that you can actually have in Jenkins. But each line here is a commit in the system, and each box is one of these quality checks that starts, like the first one actually starts doing the build and unit test. If that goes green, then it will go to the next step and see it. If it goes red, it will stop the process. The blue ones are not executed. It's not worthwhile executing them because the code didn't get to that. Wasn't good enough for that. So, and here you can actually see this is actually our
Well, what do you do if you have if you have something that breaks down in production, you find a major flaw in the system that you haven't found during the testing?
Yeah. It shouldn't take days to complete, but actually what you normally do in that situation is you make some kind of hotfix without any quality assurance whatsoever, and you do it in production. If you have a pipeline like this, then it could actually make sense running through this pipeline. I know when you said if it takes days, but it shouldn't actually really take days. Like when we, if it takes days to doing this final quality assurance, we try to parallelize it, and to run in parallel so we can get it down to take hours. And if you have a process, like you can also make special pipelines where you're only doing certain of your quality assurance tests. If you say, no, 60 hours is too much, but 2 hours is okay, or 1 hour is okay. The good thing about this when you have production errors like that is that if you have some kind of pipeline like this, you would actually run some tests before you put things into production. And you have to decide how long you're going to wait. Yes. Exactly. Yes. So you can do things like that, or you can make a special pipeline that actually handles that situation. You want some special test, like you can put it on special brands and actually set up like a special hotfix pipeline that only checks exactly what you want to do. So there's different ways of controlling that. So the good thing is that you will get some quality assurance, and in the old way you would get nothing. So I really think that's one of the places where it pays off. So, because I know we have all sat in this situation where you're doing things straight into production or putting things straight into production, and we're not quite comfortable, and we know there's, it would be nice doing some kind of validation of our code, but we don't have time to do it. So we just cross our fingers and hope that it goes. Yes. Yes, of course, like generally the principle for putting things into production is that if you're sure you're not making it worse, then it's acceptable putting things into production. If production is down, it's very difficult making it a lot worse. So that's true. But it's still nice, like even if you make a new bug and then it's still down, it's still nice having some kind of quality checks. And a lot of the time it's not 100% down, you just have some problems in special situations. And there, it would be nice maybe to run checks for 2 hours and then put it into production. So, but yes. Is anyone doing nightly builds instead of this? Because this is actually something that we try to avoid. Like it's a good starting point, but we actually like to try to do it all the time. Also because one of the things that happens with nightly build is that then you get all the feedback in the morning and you don't really, like, you want to get it immediately when you're doing some things. And if everybody has to sort of start fixing things in the morning because there's different problems, then it would be nicer to have had some of them earlier in the day when you were actually working. Yes. Yes, and doing a longer test, and that's what a lot of people are then organizing. We actually try to optimize this pipeline in a way that the first checks should be fast, and the first check should basically get back to the developer and say yes or no, like you can integrate with your colleagues, yes or no. The next steps should take longer and longer, and that you shouldn't reach them too often. Like if you always get to the last step that takes like 24 hours, then it's a problem because then you're just pushing too much stuff in that has to be run like that, and then you're forced to do it at night instead. So we actually try to design the pipeline in a way that if too much gets through, then we make it a little bit harder getting through, and then we push more of the quality check forward in the chain. And that way we can actually, a lot of the time, ensure that we don't have to schedule anything to run at night. We can always run it when it gets to that point in the phase. Because somebody else is using the database, or so then you just, and that is also a good point and an important thing is that like test environments and proper test data and all of those things are a very important part of implementing this. And if you have limitations there, then there's things that makes it hard. Yes.
We actually don't
in this environment that we are using for this automated test, we don't have testers sitting in the same environment doing manual test if we can avoid it. We recommend, and I know you cannot do that everywhere, but you should actually have plenty of test environments available for your automatic test. And then you have a process where you involve your testers, because they, like at the regression test at the end, or like the acceptance test, and say, we don't go in production before we involve those, but we actually, then we do that as the very, very last step, as a manual, and say, now we put a version over there, trigger that so they can start testing in that environment, most often. An important part of this that you should try to achieve is to have plenty of test environments. Like, it's very good if you can create your own test environments. I know there's companies where that's not so easy, but it's nice when you can. Like, it's nice when you're in a virtualized environment where you just, I need a new test environment, you create a test environment and start testing that. And if the testers need a test environment, they get their own and they test there. But we have actually, what we have seen in some of the projects where we are doing this is that quite a few of the testers we are actually converting to sit and write automated test instead of sitting and doing manual test. That's part of the goal of this, that they should write tests that can be run again and again instead of doing it manually. So the idea is actually to make them more or less out of work. No, get them to do a different kind of work. Yes. But do you change the configuration at night or?
No. No. At some point, say, okay, how it's being changed on the fly system. And of course, it leads to learning and all that stuff, but it might be like weird kind of cases that we can catch.
Yes.
Then we'll know if some test fails because some kind of word process have changed.
And I know it makes sense in a lot of different situations to do it like that. I'm just saying we actually try to book a big effort into trying to really make this a pipeline that runs automatically and as soon as it's possible. And we have actually seen, we have places where we really see that this optimize the use of the test environment, because instead of them only being used at a certain time, they're actually running all the time. Like, you just use your test environment a lot more. It's just hardware, so it makes a lot of sense to use them. But again, with this, and I say now, we have to see. This is actually a Java application. This is a plugin that we deliver into the Jenkins community. So here we actually have deployment, which is just copying a API file, so it's not that it's an easy deployment. And that's the last step, and that is actually a manual process. So that's why the green ones don't go to the first one, is that somebody actually has to push the button and say, now we want to release it and copy it out to the community. But basically those two that are green and the second last are what we call release candidates. Like, we think they are good enough that we could deploy them if we wanted to. Yes, exactly. It's an automated process, but it has to be a manual decision to do it. That's what this symbolizes.
I will just try to see in.
One little thing that we have implemented here that I actually think is quite okay, that is we have made this release note generator. Because one of the good things about running it like this and having it all in this environment is you know exactly what commits are in a release compared with the last release you made. And if you follow a standard, which I think a lot of us do, that in your release comment you refer back to a case in your case handling system, then you can actually go through this and see, well, okay, how many commits did I have in here? Well, it says that I had 14 commits. It actually says that 5 of these commits are referring back to cases in our case handling systems. And it's those 2 cases. That means that we have 9 commits that don't have a proper commit message. And you can actually go to the, in this case it's JIRA, and you can read out like a release note for these cases and actually put that together. So you get an automated generated release note from the system. If you're following some kind of standard from your case to your... And this I actually think is quite a nice feature.
Otherwise, let's see, this is
I don't like again, like one of the things that is so nice and easy to do in this Java world is that you have a lot of good tools for checking all of these things. Here, I can, so we're running check style, well, we put that on, but as you can see, we're not really using it. This was an old code, and we have the usual problems that we have so many warnings that it doesn't make sense doing anything with. But the FindBugs and the PMD, looking for duplicate code, this kind of tools, I think it's really nice and a very important part of checking the quality of your code. How many of you have codings, guidelines that you are more or less enforcing?
Yes, exactly.
and that's actually, I think that is one of the things, because I think it's a problem as enforcing code guidelines. Also, if you do it in code reviews, at that time when you do the review, the code is working, you don't really want to change it just because you're not following some guidelines, because maybe you introduce an error and things like that. The time to actually be told about some things, if you have to do something about it, is when you change it in. Like at that time, you said, yeah, okay, I didn't follow the guideline, I'll fix it. So I think this is the only way of really trying to have some reasonable implementation of coding guidelines is to actually check it automatically at the time you commit. Otherwise, I think you might as well more or less forget it because people are not following it. Do you agree or disagree? So I think that's an important thing, and all of this checking for duplicate code, checking for to-dos and fix me and all of these things. I actually think as a developer it's really, really nice being told that, oh, you have this in your code, like you have a fix me in there either. Like you have to be aware about that and take that into account when you're checking coding. Of course you have the Copertura code covered when you run a unit test, it makes sense. Making a coverage report about your testing. How many of you are measuring your coverage via unit test? 1, 2? How many are you actually doing unit tests? That was a few more. So, okay. That as well is something that, because they, like we have some customers like Novo Nordisk is one, they have a goal of like basically 100% coverage of the unit test for, because of this FDA regulation. But otherwise making like some kind of fixed goal with 50 or 60% is quite hard because usually you start from more or less nothing. What we do a lot of the time is actually we introduce a rule and said it's not allowed to drop your coverage. So that means that if you make one new line of code, you have to make some kind of unit test. And that is actually a good way of ensuring that it's slowly getting better. You could find some other code to delete instead. That was another way still of ensuring that you pass. And you could write a unit test to somebody else's code, that would also be okay. So you can be creative that way, but you actually sort of ensure, like, I think deleting code is very productive. I think it's good people deleting code that are not used, so.
I think that's sort of okay. For false coverage.
Yes.
I will, no, we have, but I will talk more about that later because it's actually on the subject.
Otherwise, is there any comments or questions to this? This is our main view that we actually have on the screens. It's one thing that is very useful for the developers, and you can see it, and it's running the pipeline every time something is happening. But I'm actually the project manager on this project as well, and it's very useful for me because I can go in and see exactly, like I can find in here and exactly when we did a release of it and what commits were in it, and now we didn't do a release for a long time. But still, so there is a lot of information in this system, not just for the developers, but for the whole project. And it gives a very nice overview of the status of the project. So like components and yes, I have something. I have something about that too. Actually, I like it when you ask questions that I'm planning to talk about. I'll go a little bit into the maturity model because implementing this basically when you're starting a new Java application. You have Maven, you have Jenkins, you have these tools, is like something you can do in a few hours. So that's not the difficult part, and that's not the problem most of us are in. Like, there's a lot of other things that prevent us from just doing that. And this is basically what we call our maturity. We have made this maturity model, but like it's not a question really of giving a score for our maturity. It's more like some kind of it's a basic for talking together about where are we and how mature do we think we are in these different areas, and is there something that we have to do, what we have to do it better in these areas to actually be able to do continuously. And you can discuss a lot about what things should be in this. Like, we don't have system architecture in here at the moment, but I think it should be. Like, your system architecture is a very important part of how easy it is for you to automate your test of your code. So it would make a lot of sense having that, but we don't at the moment. But we have tried to specify these four areas that we think are very important. If you're not at a certain maturity level or in these areas, it's very hard to automate your quality assurance. And we talk about our build process, the test, the QA, your version control system, we consider very important. The last one is like visibility. It's actually the fact that you would like to put these things on a screen and put out on a big room showing to the whole project, team management, even your customer, if you're brave, to us is also maturity level concerning these things. We often get into discussions when we start talking about these things, about if your build is, if it's scripted or if it's, if you can do it using Maven with specifying your POM, or if you have long build scripts. Like, we have been into places where it's amazing how much code people have written to do their builds. And it is scary sometimes. And it's amazing how much you can actually throw away by trying to do it in a different way. And most places where we see that is actually that nobody really dares to touch it because the guy that wrote it isn't there anymore. And they just have like scripts after script after script, and they have no idea what it's doing, but it's sort of working, and nobody there touching it. To us, it really makes a sense cleaning up your build and having it, like simplifying it and having it work, and you have to ensure that you have under control that you can build and build and build again, not just on one machine, the magic build machine, but it's actually something you can reproduce in different environments. Does anyone recognize issues, problems with build systems? I find it amazing, especially this, that there's one developer's PC that can build this part of the application. Then another machine can build something else, and nobody can figure out how to change that. It's amazing. I will talk a little bit about some of the areas in this, this model, if I can. Code metrics and these things. To me, and this is actually one of the things that sort of pisses me off a little bit with Scrum and things like that. It tells you that if you just work with the Scrum rules and stuff, you get you can deliver software, but all of the architecture things and how you ensure that you're changing your code all the time and it's not like getting like more and more complicated, more and more spaghetti. How do you ensure that you're fixing that? I don't think a lot of people talk about it in the agile world. And I really think that that's the most part and most important part of success is that you're actually like you have your architecture under control, you ensure that your code is always improving a little bit, not going getting a little bit worse every time you make a change. So I really think that it's important that you try to control your software entropy. Like your software, every time you touch your code, it should be a little bit better. It shouldn't be a little bit worse. I think that's an important principle. And to me, some of these tools can help you try to do that. I'm not saying this is the whole solution, definitely not. Because I think there's a lot of architectural issues and things like that. I think this is a difficult area, but I think the tools can actually help you try to ensure that your code is moving in the right direction, not in the wrong direction. Is there something you recognize as a problem, or? Now we're back to the test that you were asking about, because what we actually see a lot of the time is that people mix a little bit what we call unit test and functional test. Because a unit test that you want to measure coverage on, really just have to take that test, that unit. Otherwise, as you said, you get some bad results when you're measuring your coverage. And you're not really testing the unit. Like unit testing is a question about testing a specific unit. Does that do what you expect it to do? And it has to be fast because it's actually something you want to do and quickly tell the developers yes or no. So we put a big effort into separating these two kind of tests. We actually, a lot of the time, we use the unit test framework to run our functional tests. But we put them into a later process in the Jenkins pipeline, and we call it functional test. It can be called by the unit test framework, that's okay, but it's still a functional test. It's not a unit test. And if we do unit test, like you really have to stop it. Like, otherwise, it's not a unit test. You want to test the functionality of that unit if you want to do it. So, and they have to be fast. The functional test can run like for hours, days if it's necessary, depending on your setup. And if they run for days, you can then try to optimize it by buying more hardware and running in parallel and stuff like that. Reviews. How many is doing code reviews? Quite a few. Which is actually a good idea, but and I always have some questions when you're doing reviews. What do you do when you find things? Do you fix it immediately? Do you put it into like work items that we fix for the next release? What is your because one of the problems with code reviews to me if you find something serious, it's a bit late because at the time you do the code review, the code should be working, and it's fairly expensive trying to fix some design issue or something when the code is already working. Do you really want to spend time doing that because it is working? You might introduce a different error if you try to fix it. So but of course there's things that you can only see with a human eye and things. We try to advocate and. Maybe that's not the right answer, but like you want to find these design things that are critical that you have to fix. You really want to fix before you do a formal review, like before you start writing the code. If it's pair programming or design, like previews or whatever, but you really like to find that early. And if it's a question of finding things that are more like comments and say, like that could be sometimes the format code and things like that, that you could actually find maybe with some of the automated tools. So this is what we try to do in these situations. But I know it's difficult, and I know a lot of the time it makes sense actually doing formal reviews. But we see quite a few places that do have views, but then they still don't do it because it's a fairly expensive way of assuring quality for your code. Like it takes a lot of time to do. And again, if you then have the issue, if you really want to invest the time in fixing the issues also, then it doesn't always work so well. Yeah, this is the deployment, and of course, this is like this is an easy way of just saying yes. Of course, you have to do automated deployment so you can do some functional testing. And sometimes it's just copying a raw file, and sometimes it's a lot more difficult than that. Again, I think it makes sense. It makes sense doing a lot. Use all of those tools also that you can use Chef and things like that for controlling your configurations for different environments and things like that. But I have to admit, it's not what we are doing a lot of our work on. Branching. Do you use branches? Sometimes. Do you consider it a good idea using branches? Exactly. I know, like the first one, the node branching is like I'm quite. I think it's interesting with the ThoughtWorks people that really say continuous delivery, and the way that you can ensure that your code can go in production all the time is using node branches. And if you have something that is not ready, like to go in production, then you have to somehow else configure your code so it's not really intervening with anything. But don't put it on branches. You want to integrate all the time with your colleagues, and you don't want to use any branches. I think it's an interesting way of looking at it. I'm not sure I completely agree with it. We actually like branches because you can use them for a lot of different things. Like you can use them like to control things you're working on before you share with your colleagues. Like you can work in a team before you share with the whole group. And you can use them for controlling your process as well by moving things from a stable branch to a release branch, things like that. So there's a lot of things with the branching that it can be used for. So in that extent, it's a very important tool to say that you don't want to use it at all. But, and I think an important thing is to actually use a tool where you can use branches, like Git, something like that, but also to at least invest enough time in your version control system that you have your branches under control and you understand how you use them. And I think one of the frustrating things we hear from a lot of subversion people is that the branching is so hard, so we don't do it. So then, like either learn well enough that you can actually do it because it's possible, or otherwise find a different tool and it's not so hard. Yes. And that makes sense, and of course it's like part of this continuous integration is of course that you are only working one branch and you're sharing all the time and you're working with trunk. And I think one of the classical way also with the Git talks about like has a standard way of using Git, and there you basically like you're always working for the next release, and that is in trunk and subversion. Yeah. Then you have the, yes, you can have feature branches. You can have developers working on feature branches. Our developers actually do that to a certain extent. Like they make their own branch for a little while if they're doing something that takes more than a day or something like that. What they usually do is that they actually set up, they copy Jenkins job and Jenkins pipeline to their own feature branch then, because they don't want to work without Jenkins. They don't want to work without this continuous check of that code. So they actually copy the stuff up and set up for their own feature branch in that period. Then they integrate from the integration branch all the time, so they ensure that the code they're working on is up to date with the integration branch. And then we actually, a lot of the time, have this pre-tested commit implemented on the integration branch. And that basically means that like your commit is rejected on the integration branch if it doesn't compile and if it doesn't run unit test. But if it passes those two, it actually goes in on an integration branch. And automatically. And after that point, it's not rejected in the way that if it doesn't pass the next quality check, it's just left there. It's just saying this commit is then not a release candidate anymore because we know it's not going the whole way through. But you're not rejecting it. It's there still as part of your integration. It was good enough to share with your colleagues, but it wasn't good enough to put it in production. Yes, when
until it's fixed.
Yes. So and I think
this is also the way it looked like when you're looking at the pipeline. Like if something is stops at a certain time or is like then. Like the next commits, of course, have those commits included and the next ones.
The only place where we reject it and when we actually don't take it into the is like at the first level at the integration stream. There we usually reject. If it doesn't build and compile, we don't want it at all. But after that, you're part of the integration process with your colleagues and you're moving forward.
But normally we are working with
Git or Mercurial distributed working, and at that time they actually that it's the developer's job. Like whoever comes first wins. And the one that comes second with it actually have to load the new code and merge and then put it up. So that's the way it's being fixed. Promotions is something else that at least it makes sense thinking a little bit about. A lot of the time, if you make up this pipeline, you basically take one commit and start quality checking it, and it gets to a certain level in this process, and it says, yes, now I passed this phase, but I didn't pass that phase. And you basically have this kind of promotion level, like how far did it get in your process? And you have different ways you can control that. In clear case, you actually have a promotion level flag, so you can actually set that on a commit and say, it got this far in my process. In other systems, you can tag it, something like that. Jenkins or some your other build server can actually control it for you. It depends a little bit on your system and setup. But it's something that makes sense being aware of, that what you do with these things is actually you're promoting the same build. It's still the same, like the same commit. It just is being promoted in the process. And this was this pre-tested integration that we like to set up. Basically, the idea that you are not allowed to get into the integration branch unless you actually built and run your unit test successfully. If you're really interested in version control and stuff like that, you can actually, there's quite some discussion also in the Jenkins world and in the Git world about how you should implement that, because you can do that in a lot of different ways. You can do it by moving things from branches to other branches. You can put things on a shelf and then basically having somebody like pulling it. You can use clones if you're working with distributed version control system. There's a lot of different ways of implementing this this process of pre-tested commit. But it's actually a quite nice feature. How many see it as a problem that the integration stream is being like destroyed, like somebody pushing in code that just doesn't compile? Does that happen often or not? Is it a problem? It could happen now. So this is actually quite a nice way of implementing it, because it basically says, sorry, you have to fix this before you go into the stream. So traceability is another thing that you actually get more or less for free if you implement this pipeline, is that you start having much better idea about the traces of your code and exactly what's happening, exactly what you're delivering. And you can use that for a lot of things, like some companies have to implement traceability. So I think some of our financial companies might actually have that as a big focus in the future because of the European Union. Like Novo Nordisk, we worked for them, had it for a long time. So, but there's a lot of other nice features about actually being able to trace where you are. I think that was going through most of the, like, sort of this maturity model. And again, we use it mainly as a way of sort of discussing like how, like, ready are we for starting implementing this? Like, do we have our things in control? Do we actually have test environments where we can test things automatically? Can we actually, or do we have our test data under control, or is it a hassle creating some test data that we need? All of these things. Any comments, questions to this? Then let's talk a little bit about what we do. This was actually the pre-tested commit. No, it wasn't pre-tested, but this was in a clear case set up at Novo Nordisk where they actually had problem with this getting things coded and working, and the integration took so long time that they actually had this lamp that like the guy that had the lamp was allowed to try to put in the code in the repository, and then if it didn't quite work, then he kept the lamp because he just wanted to fix something quickly and then push another time, so the other guys couldn't get the lamp. Then they started putting yellow stickers on the lamp. You had like a queue system on the lamp, who is allowed to try to integrate the code. So it was actually quite a pretty sight, this lamp with a lot of yellow stickers for everybody waiting to integrate, especially when it was like getting 3 o'clock in the afternoon, because they were supposed to integrate daily. So at the afternoon, everybody wanted to try to get rid of the code. So that was a fight. And actually, when we started talking with them, they asked if we could implement an automatic version of this lamp. That was basically what they wanted, so we could automate that. We ended up making like this kind of pipeline for them and ensuring that actually the first, that it was pre-tested commit, so it was basically like an automated way of controlling it, that you tried to push it, and if it didn't work, then you got it back again, and you could try to fix it, and you didn't have to like share this line more. So, but it was quite fun. I think this we talked about already, but this was a little bit with this, setting up this rule saying that your quality, like goals are not allowed to get any worse. So if you have 2% coverage, it should never be below 2%. It should only go in the right direction. And the same with a lot of other quality checks. It's actually a good way of ensuring that your code is slowly going in the right direction. So. So they don't care about quality. That is. It's difficult, let's say it that way. No, I can't tell you how you do that. This is actually something we have seen as well, in that when we start to automate these things, then suddenly we had some code in Subversion that we just couldn't get to compile. And then at the end it showed up that was because that sometimes they had problem checking in their code, one developer had, and after that he stopped checking in, started building it on his own machine. So, like for 6 months, it hadn't built from Subversion, only on his own machine. And when we started automating this, and he didn't want to tell us that, but after we were sitting there like for days and couldn't figure out why the code wasn't working, then at the end, he sort of had to admit that, said, yeah, well, yeah, I couldn't check in, so. But it works fine on my machine, I can build the code. So, somebody was talking about components, and this is actually, this is from Grundfos, which is a Danish company making pumps, and they actually work very heavily with the components. When they make a new pump, they basically say, we need this 10 software components in this, and they don't have a project with any developers assigned. They go back to the owners of these components and say, we need a new release of your component, because it has to do something else for these specific new pumps. But it's controlled by, like, there's ownership of this component. Like, there's developers sitting there and being responsible for the component. They have to deliver a new version as well. So they work, like, completely in this component-oriented way. And they have set up pipelines and checks and stuff for all of these components. one of the classical problem with that is that when you make a new version of a component for a new project, then you check it for that project, and that project is happy. In this case, project A. But you actually don't know if this new component works for all the other different projects. And they are not interested in trying it out because they're not delivering anything at the moment. They're doing something else, or they're waiting for the next release or whatever. So what do you do? Well, you don't do anything, and then when the next project asks for a new version of the component, he gets the first changes and the new changes, and then you find out that, well, the new changes that asked for were good, but the old one didn't work. And that can be like half a year after the what we actually made for one, so after the setup for the project and a lot of automated tests, we basically made like a config rotator for them and say, if we have automatic tests for this project, and we have a new version of this component, we might as well try them out. We might make like a config rotator that can load new versions of this component and try in the different projects. So project A have asked for it, but we will actually try it out in B, C, D, and E as well. And if it doesn't work, we won't actually tell those projects because they don't care. But the guy that made the component probably care. So we will tell him that the changes you made for project A doesn't work in B and C. Maybe you should look into that. And this is actually a quite a nice feature. If you're not interested, you can actually control, you set up this config rotator for the different projects, and you actually set up what components they're interested in having rotated, so you can actually tell for a specific component that this one, I don't want any new version of, I'm happy with the one I have, but for this other versions, I would like to try them out when there's new versions. So you can specify specifically for per component which one you're interested in rotating and which one you want to keep static.
Is that
the config rotator? Yes. It's a concept and actually a plugin to Jenkins we have implemented it in. It's supporting at the moment, we use it for JDKs, because we developed it first, because Confos is using that tool, but we've actually made a version for Git as well. But it's only those two systems. Yeah, but like to use it like but do you have them set up as many components in clear case? No, because the way we have set it up here, it's and that we haven't tried to do it. When we have done in clear case, it's based on this rootless component where you have the component structure below that you can control it. I think if you have a lot of components, I think the way we have done it at least is a bit cumbersome to set up and work with. But maybe it's possible to make changes where it actually works in that environment, depending how you can figure out to specify this. Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So, but then we haven't tried that, how it will work in that environment. So. How many are working with components? I'm always surprised that it's not more people. I think this idea about that your whole application is like one big component sort of irritates me a little bit, but that's in some way, but like in old days, like when I learned to program, we put a lot of effort into actually like separating your application in different parts, and there was different people responsible for them, and you actually like you when you made an application, you really put together different things, and you tried to make them shareable with other people making other applications. That didn't always work so well. I have to admit that. But just a way of organizing your code. But now it's a little bit like in modern version control, you just put it in a big chunk and it's all together and developers are changing in the same code and it's a different attitude, mentality.
Not sure that everyone
Yes. But you are thinking about that way too. Yeah, that can be true. It becomes more complicated when you have quite a number of components and you want to control the branching wise and things like that, yes. I still think, on the other hand, it's a very nice way of trying to organize your code. This is also from Conference. This is the way they test the pumps. They basically go to this machine and put on the pump and then starting pumping water out and then warm it up, and then the pump again, and then have it running like that for hours. And this we have actually set up in a Jenkins environment. So that means that instead of this machine, you had to walk down in the room and set up to make it work. Now, basically, when it gets that fire in the pipeline, it finds that this machine is available and start testing. And this is actually running 24/7 now. So they have hard finding time to maintain it at the moment, because it's... So this is actually a good example where they get a lot more out of the money they invested in the test environment, because it's testing a lot more. How many is working like in a virtualized environment where you can get new machines and new test machines and whenever you want it? Isn't it nice? This is something we are actually quite often fighting with when we are trying to get people to implement this. And then we say, and then the best way of doing it is to have this 5 or 10 virtual machines, because you need different slaves for doing this when you're testing things. And they say, but then we have to get them from the IT department, and each virtual machine is as expensive as a physical machine, so it doesn't help anything. And that I really find frustrating. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's. But it's really nice being able to scale that way and make. Yes. Exactly. And we made this like tools in a box concept, but that was basically our idea about like an easy way of configuring and said when you want to do continuous integration, you need a bunch of tools. So it makes it easy by having some VMs that you can basically just put on a virtualized environment and you're up and running, and it doesn't take much time. That one we talked about already. This one I don't want to spend time on. Why are we doing this? How are we doing for time? That's good. This is actually like a slide about most of the times we are being engaged with customers and they're trying to start doing this. This is the reason behind it. Most of the time it's quality, and most of the time it's because they have a fire. So I can't remember, I talked with some of you guys about how you change things. You create a disaster. That's the only way you change things in some of these big companies. And if you create a really big enough disaster, then you're allowed to change something. But that is the main focus we have seen. That is when there's some disaster, you put something into production and it wasn't good enough, and then you can talk your management in. So I guess that was the question about how you convince them. You stop making small changes or small problems that are being found in these tools, you create big disasters, that, and then tell them that the tool would have found it. Then you can start talking with them. Carry a big stick. No. But unfortunately, no, of course not. But unfortunately, it's true, like to a large extent. I believe we can convince our management as well. I actually believe to a certain extent that one of the big problems in our industry is that our management are not listening to us. And one of the reasons for that is that we actually have an incredible bad track record of delivering what they expect from us. They think we are useless.
a lot of the time. And they don't listen to us because they think last time you told me something, it didn't work out, so why should I listen to you now? So it's partly also our like our own problem. Like we have to try to deliver some of the things our management want. So and what they want is they want quality, of course, but they more want to actually have deadlines they can count on, so because that's what they're being measured on. So if you can start delivering something and tell your manager that we can actually finish this on time and he will get it on time, then he will start listening to about other things too. So it's not that easy, but to some extent I think it's actually partly our own fault that our management are not listening to us. Like we don't have a good track record in our industry. I mean, we are very good at making it work anyway, somehow.
Yes, exactly.
Again, the quality is a big thing. The broken process workflow is another big thing. That was like the Novo with this lamp. Like that was basically a broken process. Developer productivity, we actually have a few cases where it's really good. Can this actually make us work more efficient? And I think it can. It's actually a good argument. Time to market, according to some people, this is the most important argument for anything. If companies can deliver things quicker, this is actually where you can get the most return on investment. Also a big part. The predictability and visibility is actually, and this is I think what our management are looking for a lot of the time. If we could actually be better at telling them when we're finished with things, they would be quite happy with a lot of the things. We actually are involved with some customers that are starting requiring this from their suppliers. And I said, I want to see that you have a continuous delivery quality assurance product. I don't want to receive anything from you before you can show me something, some indication that it's working. Like we have customers that are fed up that when the supplier delivers some code, they can't even log into the system. And they basically get all the testers in and say, now we should do the request, like the acceptance test, the user acceptance test, and they can't log into the system. And everybody goes home again and go back to whatever they were doing. And say, we don't want to start a user acceptance test before we can see in this Jenkins pipeline that it's actually green and that we've done this and this and this manual testing. So this is actually a place that we're working quite a bit with now. And then, of course, this continuous delivery, there is actually some people that really want to deliver code weekly or daily into production. This is not so important. To me, this is also a big part of it. Like, when there's so many tools involved in our process, and we see so much that people are sort of making it work good enough with some of the tools. I think we should stop doing that. We should start getting our tools under control, having some pride in what we're doing, and be the master of our tools. I think it's actually cheaper and better doing it that way. No. But I think somebody in your company, especially a company that the size of yours, should be masters of the tools you're using. And if you don't think it's worthwhile investing in having masters in the tools, then I think you should find some simpler tools or another way of doing things. I think it's very expensive having tools that you don't even master, especially if you have a lot of people using them. So some people should master them, but not. Yes, but I think that that's fine. But I think that is also a little bit of a dangerous way of looking at it. I think you should simplify your tool setup so you can master it. And if you think it's too expensive mastering, then I think you should have a simpler tool set. So, why are you interested in continuous delivery? Tell me. So then that's the quality issue of getting like the quality like checks moved earlier in the process, so you actually find problems earlier.
So the quality has to leave QA team and have
deploying once again and again.
That to me makes a lot of sense. You? So that's all of, yes. 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 And this idea about automating, I think, is a very important part of it, too.
So right now, we do not have actual delivery into production. So we are not very interested in this.
Yeah.
To actually have the day off when we arrive.
Fantastic feature.
Okay.
I thought you guys were more worried about the morning when the customer started using your systems. Exactly. So. So you like the scripting part of it?
Yes, and automating. So.
Yeah. Did anyone see there was a guy on TV a while ago talking about why? New Guinea didn't develop the same way as we did here. Basically, the message was that it was so difficult getting food, and they didn't start doing farming, so they spent all the time getting the food, so they didn't have any time to innovate or do anything else. They were too busy doing their day-to-day work. Where when we started farming, we actually got a little bit of spare time, and that's when we started moving forward. So I think that's a message also for like trying to work in a different way that we can actually get a little bit of spare time. There's also, I think that's an important part also, talking about the tools, is that, chefs, they actually practice their knife skills. Like, making food is not just a question of what you put in and how you eat your food. You actually have to be good with a knife, because if you don't control your knife, you're too slow in the kitchen. You have to practice your knife skills if you want to be a good chef. And I think the same as a developer. There's a lot of things you have to practice if you want to be a good developer. And it's not just a question of Java and controlling that and bytecodes and all things like that. I think that's an important part of it too. You really have to understand your programming language, but you also have to understand some other tools and things like that. And I think that is an important part of it if you want to be good at what you're doing. And there's a lot of tools you have to learn about now if you really want to control it. Yes. Yeah. So you have to. Yes. I think on the other hand, if we want to compete with programmers in India, I think the only way we can compete is being very good at what we're doing. And I think this is like our professional pride is all a question about. Like we have to be masters of our tools and everything.
I don't know if you can read this. Somebody made this manifesto for software craftsmanship. I just found that.
I don't think it became very big. But I just like the idea that it's not just a question of saying we are like Agile Manifesto. Like software is a trade, like we have to be good at it. Yes, but that means that you never stop looking at it. Like, if this idea that now you have scripted everything and then it's working doesn't really work out that way. It breaks, like everything breaks, and then you have to look into it. So I think you have to have somebody responsible for this area and fixing it and improving it. That's something else. You don't just leave it that way. Like, you always have new ideas and new things you can do. So there should be somebody responsible working with this pipeline and improving it. So, like, we actually try to argue in projects that if you're 10 developers, it actually makes sense spending time on this, because the guy spending time on this should make the other 9 guys more efficient. And that can actually pay off. Yes. Yes.
And you have to have backup for that, and especially in big companies, it shouldn't really be a problem because you can share them between teams.
But exactly, and I think that is very important. You should ensure that you always can do things. And I think in the Java world, and I really think that's a good thing, is that yes, of course, there's a lot of tools, and you have to learn to understand Git and stuff like that. But it's not that bad. Like, actually, it's quite good and simple tools, so it's possible to understand them. Like it's much worse in the C++ world, trust me. So you guys are lucky. Like this is the easy. You just have to understand Jenkins and Git and yes, exactly.
Well, nobody understands Maven
if it doesn't work.
So yes.
But they're all fun tools. And I think this is more or less the last thing about what we do. Basically, it is a question. You start with integrating, continuous integration. You start to automate everything, and the things you can't automate, you ensure that you can automate. So you divide and conquer. I also like the component stuff. Can you run pipelines individually on pieces of your code? You create your pipelines, and you start optimizing them and keeping working on them all the time. And you make toll gates where you check and say if you're not good enough for this level, you don't get any further. And then you just keep on improving that. It's not a big project you have to start up front, it's just something you start with, you integrate it, and then you keep on improving it. Small steps in the right direction. And you can do it while you're driving. And this is of course very important with everything that you want to implement. You always try to find some low-hanging fruits that you can actually show some results in the beginning. That's always a good way of trying to convince management that it makes sense what you're doing. Are we for time?
10 minutes?
That's good.
Functionality, I just have a couple more comments here, and then I think, but functional versus integration test, and this is something like, our experience, and I don't know if you agree with me, that is that implementing unit tests is actually something that it's an expensive way of improving quality. Like it's not something that you start seeing quality immediately and say, yeah, we have to have 60% commas and then our quality improves. It takes a long time improving that way. Our experience is that it actually makes sense putting effort on the functional testing, automating some of that in the beginning. And then when you start doing new projects, and if you're doing test-driven development, that's fine, like do unit tests. But to existing projects, functional test gives a lot more added value than unit test, is our experience. And this with the design discussions, code review, stuff like that, I think I talked about already. I think that was, if you don't have more questions or comments, then that was about the words that I had for you.